And there is a call on the part of our bishops in the Philippines to cultivate a strong sense of mission agentes, that by 2021, the 500 years of evangelization in the Philippines should be concretely marked by priests, consecrated persons, and laity doing mission agentes to Asian countries, responding concretely to the call of the popes. Kindly comment on that and be as concrete as possible in terms of this, that the health of a church is measured in its capacity to do mission. That the more missionary the diocese is, the more it is a healthy particular church. That's my first question. Any one of you can just answer that. Number two is that I have been hearing these two phenomena, secularism and religious fundamentalism. And I think our country is pinned between secularism and religious fundamentalism. How do we create a culture in our country to at least respond concretely to these two threats and opportunities of fundamentalism and secularism? Those two, thank you.
Regarding the first question, my answer would be taken from Paul's letter to the Romans. We have been gifted, now it's time to share the gift, that gift of faith. And by virtue of baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist, we have no choice but to actualize that the church is missionary and that the church should always be in mission. A church that is self-referent, a church that is inward-looking, is not the church we need today. Therefore, we are urged to go, not to convert people, because conversion is God's work, but to share our faith with other peoples. Mission is ad gentes. And the best form today of mission ad gentes is witnessing. Just be there. And our presence would count much. I've been around the Pacific for many years, also in Asia. A church that is not missionary seems to be doomed to die. Because a missionary church must always be linked with other churches. A church cannot be on its own. A church must belong to the other churches, to other peoples. And it is here that we share our particular experience of the faith. That's what I think about that this evening. Number one.
I take from the Angelo that very clear gospel. I have so much you do to others. And so, first, who are the
others? There is that
extra. And an intra. Paul the Sixth made that very clear. In the church, among ourselves, the need for dialogue, sharing within the church. That is now very, very specific to the Philippine situation, that within the nominal church, there are so many brethren who are not any more than just what the word is. So that word, we have so many from our ranks, an awakening. And then, the abject test, there are two types. Gen test an extra and gen test an intra. Always, gen test must mean people. And so the rediscovery of the others as people of God, as children of God, as blessed with the destiny for whom Christ died. So line up all these motivations. Who do not share in the mission being sent to the others? That's a bit. Mission means you are sent to the others. If that is not part of our consciousness, then we have not even been listening to Christ yet. That's that. Okay, you number two.
There's a story that goes this way. When Paul was very busy preaching, he had a mild stroke, so he went to a doctor. And the doctor listened to the heart of Paul. And what did the doctor hear? Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. It is a simple story. But I think it is very important and challenging. We cannot monopolize the good news. It has to be shared. And I'm very happy that there are many diocesan priests going to the mission. That there are also many diocesan priests studying mission. Not only in the Philippines, or let's say in the Philippines. From Vietnam, I have more than 100 students, former students, within a period of 15 years. Sisters and diocesan priests studied, came to Manila to study missionology. Question number two. There are two phenomena that are insidiously affecting the lives of many Christians, many Catholics for that matter, even in the Philippines. First is secularism. Secularism results from progress in science and technology. Meaning to say, our lives now are very much impacted by what we make as progress in science and technology. And because of that, we set aside the traditional understanding of a life that must have meaning in God. Today, we would rather go to the Mercury drugstore than go to the chapel and pray for healing. That is a sign of secularism. I heard this as one of the examples given during our conference in Chiang Mai. It was organized by the FABC. If we are not careful, we become secularized, meaning men and women of the world rather than men and women of God. Make a choice. Now, fundamentalism is one of the phenomena that is emerging today, especially because of globalization. If you look at globalization like this, there are two sides of it. One is fundamentalism and or tribalism. And the other one is totalism. What does that mean? Countries or peoples join globalization. There are for globalization. The other side is they are against globalization. Why? Because of the fear that they lose much of their identity, much of the legacy handed down to them from generation to generation. Whereas here, they are open to innovations, they are open to other things. Now, where should we stand? We stand in the middle, and that is integration of what is good from this side and what is good from the other is the stem of missiology. We stay in the middle and dialogue with them. A very good example of fundamentalism that is of a fundamentalist group would be the Muslims. The Muslims are against globalization because today, if you have no education, you are doomed to be a victim of globalization. So, from the reaction against globalization, we have fundamentalists. They want resources more back to the tradition, back to the old ways, back to the archaic. And if they are politicized, they become terrorists. And they do so, terrorizing the world in the name of religion, in the name of God. There are many people responding to globalization in two ways. First, join. The other one, go against it. The third one will be, why not have a dialogue with globalization? Meaning to say, as a concept, it has two sides. Therefore, it is subject to debate. Look at our own personal lives. I know a professor somewhere in the Pacific. He is totally against globalization, but he has the latest gadget in the world. Meaning to say, does he really understand globalization? Globalization is not new, it is very old, but it has emerged again because of science and technology. Look at the Eucharistic prayer number 3. From the rising of the sun to its setting down, from many peoples and cultures, come people to the kingdom of God. We have to take globalization as it comes, but be selective in the changes that we can adapt to, brought about by science and technology. Question number 2.
Secularism and fundamentalism have something in common. It is an anthropocentrism. Secularism is a direct offshoot of the Enlightenment, man discovering himself and his capacity. Man, as juvenile, for the first time, experiencing the self, the identity, and like a child learning to walk, wanting no hand of an adult to guide him by, would like to be alone, to do his own thing. That is, the secularist, anthropologically speaking, where we have, so to say, discovered our independence and we do not want to be told by a God what to do. And so, we tell God, 50 years ago, actually, even earlier in the late 19th century, the death of God ideology. God, go back to heaven, leave us to ourselves. And that kind of secularism is found in Freemasonry. They still retain the name and the symbol of God, but ultimately, ideologically, they believe God has already distanced himself from us, and therefore we must carry on our own. So, fundamentalism follows the same group of man discovering himself, what he considers for his identity. And these are some of these traditional tenets. He understood his own way and things he is familiar with. And that's why, as Father Ed said, in globalization, there you get a rush of things coming in from outside, from far away, completely new. And you reject them because you are more secure, like a juvenile, like an adolescent. You're more secure in this, and that's why you do not want something completely foreign or new. You find this in children. You notice that they like a certain food, they don't want even to try new food, new dish. You encounter that again and again. So, the here and now of secularism and what I am familiar with in fundamentalism, they tell us anthropologically certain juvenile state or in the maturation process of the human being. And so it applies variously, but the pattern is there, it repeats itself, and we have to be familiar with it because it can happen to us also. Remember, the church was once upon a time fundamentalist also, because the church had not really paid attention to others, to culture. Globalization made the culture of others something immediate. And so we got out of it, so to say. The other seven, Iglesia ni Cristo, cannot passively think of others contributing to their own body of information or even learning. And I think that the challenge, both challenges, is best met by the persons we are as evangelized, as transformed. If you are not transformed, you have no message to deliver. You have only noise to make. And you are not a missionary if you make noise. You are a missionary if you have light to share. And that light, you must be living. Otherwise, it's not light. It's just a theory. It's just a conjecture.
One thing consoling today is the emergence, re-emergence of religion. Not from the center, but from the margins. However, we ask what kind of religion? Something that is less doctrinal and more experiential. That is why evangelical view makes sense. Not so much knowledge about Jesus Christ that we have to proclaim, but we share our personal experience of Jesus Christ.